everybody. I hope you had a great week. We've got a Saturday again, and this is right time for our show City of Heart. You are listening to Miss B, and today we talk about certainty from a male perspective. You know, last time I was telling you about my excitement about the spring coming up in London, in Britain. During the week it got really cold, and because we talk about certainty, it got me thinking that, you know, not even weather is certain. So maybe I've got a question for all of us to think about whether we really need certainty in our life. And if you want to share with me your opinions, your thoughts, you can email me to ceo@cityofheart.org.uk. And don't forget to like the Facebook page of City of Heart. Just go to www.facebook.com/charity.city.of.heart and like the page. You can also follow me on Twitter and get a daily affirmation. So now let's do some business. I would like to take you to southern part of Africa. We're going to go to Zimbabwe again. I want to introduce you a really lovely man. He's an artist and he does many different things, and he's a very interesting person. So let's listen to what he's got to say about certainty in the world of a man. So let's go. Dumi, welcome to my show. Thank you for your time. Can you introduce yourself, please? Where you come from, who you are, what you do?
My name is Dumi Senda. I'm a Zimbabwean, but I live in St. Albans, and I've lived here in the UK for about 15 years now. But I'm still very much in touch with Zimbabwe and Africa. So that's me. I'm a poet. I'm a children's writer. I'm a community leader. You know, I do a few things, but mostly to do with the community.
Yeah, I know you do many things, but you always do them with heart. That's why you are here today.
Thank you.
So today we talk about certainty. Last week we talked about the same thing, but from female perspective. Today we've got you here, so I would like to ask you to focus on your male perspective. Yeah. So certainty. If I give you a scale 1 to 10, 10 is the most certain, 1 or 0 is almost nothing. How certain do you feel in life, just at the moment, in general? What number?
That's an interesting question, because I would say I feel positive about life, but certain, you know, because I'm also aware that, you know, nothing in life is certain, right? You know, I could be chatting to you this one moment, and then the next minute I'm unable to, because maybe, you know, God forbid I'm dead, you know. So nothing is certain in that sense. But in terms of, you know, life itself, the moments lived, you know, you just appreciate every moment and try to live positively. So I'm more persuaded, you know, to say, you know, I feel positive about
it. Okay, so you're not going to say number.
No, I'm not going to say, no, if that's all right. But
absolutely. So, okay, so you know, you've tackled it a little bit. So what does certainty mean? Maybe in your life, or maybe in life of a man, does it have any meaning, as any importance?
I think it does, probably in everyone's life, because, you know, I guess, you know, certainty perhaps is something to do with assurance, or being feeling a sense of being reassured, and a sense of value in, you know, within yourself and within the community within which you exist. And for a man, you know, men, we have, if you like, traits that are typical to us men. And, you know, these could be, okay, traits and expectations, which may include, you know, feeling the sense of the provider, that sense of being in control of the situation, you know. So these are expectations. But so when you are uncertain that you can achieve this, it can be a source of frustration in that sense.
Mm. Very interesting. So you said that it's about maybe having the control over the situation, but you mentioned nothing certain in life. So how do you cope with it, with this knowledge that there is nothing certain, but you actually, as a man, you feel you have that need to have a control over the situation?
I think, you know, it's, I once attended a course on masculinity, you know, where we were learning about what does it mean to be a man, you know, mm-hmm. what was the concept of masculinity. And I think it's a very interesting concept because probably one that has evolved too. You know, perhaps back in the days, to be a man, you had to be, you know, it was about, you know, the Brutus out there getting it, you know, hunter-gatherer kind of thing, which to an extent, I guess, you know, went in life space suits, yes. But then actually being a man also involves, you know, being able to deal with emotions, being able to, not only your emotions, but other people's emotions as well in your life. So it's about balance, you know, it's and realizing that actually control doesn't mean controlling someone else. It means controlling yourself, because you can't control other people and not be abusive. The minute you try to control someone else, you're being abusive. But if you can control your own emotions, and then, you know, that way you impact people in a different way, hopefully in a positive way.
Yeah. Okay. What do you think is the advantage, because you were talking about uncertainty, being able to control your own emotions, not to be abusive. So when you feel certain, yeah, let's say my previous example, 1 to 10, you feel certain up to level 9, yeah, which is pretty good, probably.
Very good, yeah.
So what is the impact on your relationships, on your everyday life, on your quality of life?
I think the impact will be positive if it's a shared certainty. You know, while life itself is not a certain thing, but then if you can reassure each other, if you can share your experiences, including your uncertainties, you know, but the fact that you're able to share your vulnerable moments together, then therefore creates a sense of certainty within the relationship itself. You know, so you become a source of positive energy for each other, you know. So while you're not guaranteed that you're going to live forever, the two of you, but you're guaranteed that the moments that you share together are positive because, you know, to use that word, saying that people use, you've got each other's back, you know, in that sense, yeah.
Okay, so you started talking about relationship or about a partnership already. That makes me think, you know, it probably involves trust. Because, you know, to be able to share with each other and have each other's back, you have to trust that person will be there for you when you need them.
But you also have to allow yourself to be vulnerable, you know. I find, you know, people are too guarded sometimes, you know.
Yeah.
Because, in fact, by just being too guarded actually means you're not trusting. You know, so you're right, you know, it's
absolutely
about trust. Yeah. So, but for you to be able to trust anyone, you have to, you know, allow yourself to be vulnerable to an extent, you know. So in other words, you allow yourself to fall knowing that someone else is going to catch you, you know.
Absolutely. Do you think that, because you said, yeah, we talked about trust, that's important in order to feel certain about our relationship. So do you think that there might be some roots back in your, I don't know, your childhood, the way you were brought up, the environment you lived through your life? Do you think that there is some impact or it could influence you, you know, in some negative or positive way that leads you to a certain way how you deal with problems in your relationship?
I think that's a very important point because we are all a product of our, you know, of our experiences, you know, present and past, and especially past. So in many ways that accentuates the whole point of parental responsibility, because if someone is a parent, you have to realize that you're shaping someone how they're going to be. Well, although of course as an adult you're responsible for your own actions, but you cannot discount or take away from the fact that, you know, how we were brought up. So if you grew up seeing men respecting women, if you grew up seeing women in your life being treated like equals and not subordinate to men per se, if there's not that patriarchy, if you like, that culture, then, you know, you're likely to also relate with women in a positive way. So I think community in that sense is a big responsibility in the sense that sometimes we need to challenge, you know, certain cultures, you know, and certainly from where I come from, I think we have, you know, issues of, you know, if you look at the region, most of Africa and perhaps Southern Africa, we've got, you know, a big problem at the moment where, you know, in countries like South Africa, they're talking about every second someone gets raped. And then, you know, and then you think, okay, so what's causing this? You know, just reflecting on it, you realize that a boy is never born. Then at one point they were a little boy, at one point they were a little innocent child. They were not born an abuser. So what went wrong?
Oh, thank you for that. Absolutely.
So what went wrong between them being born this innocent, you know, child we all love, and you know, into becoming this monster. That's where, of course, I mean, there's no one straight answer, but then it points to us as a community. We've got a responsibility to raise these kids in the right way. You know, to the issue of abuse is not only an issue for women. It's also in trying to protect women. We also have to educate boys. So that they learn how
absolutely, yeah, educate, but also I think that, because you know, when we are little, we observe and what we see around, and what is the first thing we see our mother and father, how they treat each other, and that's what we think it's normal, because that's what we see, and we are like a sponge, we soak it in.
Yeah,
and then when there is some crisis, that's the automatic thing we go for, you know, subconsciously.
It's the comfort zone, isn't it?
Comfort zone, yeah. Actually, you just advertised it your heart now. because this is what I believe in, that we need to work on role modeling.
Absolutely.
So, yeah, when we've got, you know, healthy relationship, which are coming from our fathers, then our daughters and our sons will create healthy future, healthy relationship, healthy families.
Absolutely. So we need to go back to the child is not raised by individuals, the child is raised by the village, you know. There's some families who do not have a father in that home, but that doesn't stop, you know, the uncles, that doesn't stop the neighbors being positive role models to this child, you know. So the village is a responsibility, you know.
I always question myself, big dilemma for me, or just when I've got a conversation with other people, culture. Really strong element of our life, and maybe that's connected to village because that's the power of masses. But on the other hand, we've got our heart, and the heart, I believe that when we really go into it, we listen to ourselves, to that conscious, we've got the answers for our questions.
Absolutely.
But sometimes the answer coming from our heart is different to answer coming from our community or the masses. And we sometimes call it culture, tradition. So what to do in this dilemma? Because we don't want to disrespect culture, because that's a part of our identity. But also we are our identity itself in our heart.
It's an interesting one, isn't it? But I think, yeah, it's one that I've also been reflecting on, you know, interesting that you have been too. This concept of, is identity a very stagnant thing, or is it something that evolves? And in as far as culture is concerned, we have to, I think, you know, accept that culture is, you know, a repeated behavior over a long period of time that has become accepted within a community as the way to do things, to practice things. But that's not to say it cannot be reformed or challenged even or stopped. I mean, if we look at every community, almost every community, you know, used to, you know, there's people come back from the days of cannibalism and all these were cultures back then. Perhaps they were acceptable then, you know, or move it forward. People used to kill twins, you know. If someone had twins, it was seen as a curse in, you know, in some parts of the world. But do we continue behaving in the same way just because it's culture? And so I think there's a sense that we can now listen to the heart, like you're saying, you know, and then begin to realize that actually before we are our cultures, before we are our identity, actually our first identity is humanity. You know, everything else is modeled around what goes inside.
I call it plastic creation, that the humanity itself is the purity and what we create, and we can be right or wrong.
Absolutely.
So if we are aware of these possibilities, we can keep growing, we can keep improving.
Absolutely.
And then, yeah, we don't have to kill twins, we don't have to abuse our partners, whatever. To be able to change the culture, or just move on. I think that you need to be certain in yourself. You need to know who you are. You need to be proud of it, and you need to be able to stand up for your own truth.
Absolutely, because there are going to come times when you have to oppose the masses. You know, the masses are saying one thing, and you're going to have to say, actually, no.
And it can be so confusing.
It's confusing.
Because the mass has got the power.
It's got the power, you know. Sometimes we call it democracy. But how about if this democracy is actually against what you stand for as a human being, you know. If this democracy means, you know, we're putting our children in danger, do you just go with it because the masses have spoken? So, yeah, it takes a bit degree of resolve and strength and courage, and certainty.
Okay, so what would you say to guys? How to encourage yourself? How to create some kind of comfort within myself to be able to stand up for my own truth and maybe against my culture? Or I don't really want to use word against because we are not in the battle.
No, it's
you know, we are not fighting because fighting, aggression, power, it's all wrong, I think. It's just
it's more like reforming as we
go. Yes, that's nice.
There are good parts of, you know, certain cultures, but there are also parts that we can do without, you know. I think it's about, again, looking at yourself and saying, you know, you always have to be a template willing to learn, I think, you know. I find being open to learn from other cultures, not only your own culture, also you be interested in other cultures. When you learn from other cultures, it actually, when you're certain within yourself who you are, you know your identity, but then you're also open enough to learn positive things from other cultures. That's life, isn't it? You know, that's humanity. There's a reason why God created us and put us all on one planet. If he didn't want that, he would have put big walls that, you know, you'd never meet anyone. So, but the reason that, you know, we've got this planet that brings us all together is so that we learn from one another, really, you know.
Absolutely, I remember when I was in Malawi, I just learned so much for my own life. Something completely was alien to me. And then I realized, actually, that we used to have it here where I live. But then we lost it because we started chasing unimportant.
Right.
So now, you know, coming back to it, it's a beautiful recognition and remembering what is actually important. So, you know, I believe that when we think we've learned enough, we reach the top, we are just right at the beginning. When we reach one top, we realize that, oh, there is something higher. So let's climb the next top.
That's what... you know, Papa Mandela said himself, you know, he said, you know, I walked this long journey, you know, and then I reach a mountain, and I think I'm now standing on the peak of the mountain, only to realize there's another mountain that I have. That's life, you know.
Life is never ending journey.
No.
Okay, so I think that now is the right time because, dear listeners, we are receiving a beautiful gift from Dumi today. As he mentioned at the beginning, he is a poet. He's an amazing poet,
and
he's spreading peace, you know, you do. So, we've got a gift because you are so kind and you created a poem specifically for
City of Heart.
For City of Heart and for our listeners. So
absolutely.
Thank you so much, and I would like to ask you whether you could present it.
Okay. This one is called Love. 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 Love fiercely, love dearly, love not nearly merely, love cheeringly, love my love, love like a dove, searingly my love, love all-encompassingly, love daringly and daringly, not fearingly my love, love. Love, love. Thank you.
Thank you. That was very beautiful. It's actually, you know, very motivating to love, very encouraging.
Love is a beautiful thing, isn't it? We just need to share more of it, really. So,
you know, I feel that sometimes when we meet somebody who we feel they could match with us, we try to push them away because, you know, we are scared of getting what we getting disappointed, or just maybe we are worried that we are actually getting something what we really wanted, something perfect.
Exactly, and it scares us, doesn't it?
Mm.
It's a bit like light, you know. If you're coming from outside and then suddenly you're confronted with light, you know, it blinds you a little bit, doesn't it?
Yeah. You feel like it's too much.
It's too much.
Yeah, too much that you can't really. You want to see and you can't really see.
You can't really see. So yeah.
Yeah, that's interesting. I'm thinking because our life, it's all about pain and pleasure, dark and light. Yeah. So I'm wondering, when we reach that peak of certainty in our relationships, what happened next? What do you think?
That's the thing, because you know, it's a bit like we're a bit like children now. You know, you're always looking for something sweeter. You've got it, but then, you know, it just never seems to be enough. I mean, the same concept with life, really. You know, we don't stop to see the blessing of being alive. You know, we've got people around us, you know, facing tragedy, some dying in car accidents, but we're here, we're able to still live, we're still able to dream. You know, that is a blessing, and so it's like a jar of honey, and we should savor it and enjoy it while we're here, instead of thinking, oh, what next, you know. So we need to learn to be in the presence, I think.
Oh, you know? Yes, yeah. Living the
in
now.
In the presence, yes. Yeah. Doesn't mean you do, being living the now doesn't mean you don't plan for the future, but it just means you're content with, you know, you're satisfied with what you've been dealt, you know.
And you mentioned future, but I want to also say that it's important to stop living the past.
Absolutely.
Because also, speaking of relationships, we often live the past, and that's what holds us back. That's the fear, and that's maybe the push, because we are worried that we will be hurt, we will experience the same thing like in our previous relationship.
Absolutely.
Somebody will hurt us again, but then we are not giving them chance to heal our wounds.
No, we're not giving ourselves a chance to heal our own wounds.
Absolutely, you know? Yeah. And we are wasting our life because we live something what already happened.
Exactly. It's about realizing that inner strength, you know. But the inner strength is not being a war. Sometimes you have to learn. There's a point where you have to learn to hide behind the wall and be vulnerable. Sometimes you have to be the wall yourself. Sometimes you have to let people lift you up a bit, you know. It's a balance, isn't it? So
yeah, I'm thinking, you know, certainty, when we feel certain, then we will start creating, like maybe subconsciously, something that breaks it down and we feel uncertain again because we like the buzz of building something or just climbing the mountain.
Yeah. Yeah, we are addicts of misery and pleasure.
Yeah. Yeah. So I just want, you know, like we always do it, a little advice for women, because you are a man.
Oh, my God.
What is it we do wrong? What is the biggest mistake we do? How to make you feel certain in relationship as a man?
Immediately I would like to say, you know, I would not make such a sweeping statement and say, what do women, I think that would be, for a start, that would be very dangerous.
Well, yeah.
I think it's about realizing that if you're in a relationship, you're sharing an experience with someone, you know, it's never going to be perfect. You're going to have to learn to balance each other off. You're going to have to learn to bounce off each other's energies, you know. However, we cannot run away from those traits that I mentioned earlier on, that, you know, men are a certain way. And we can't deny that. I know I've written endless poems about equality, and I really believe those, you know, to say actually we're all human beings, we're all equal. And so, you know, I'll be the first to walk out of a room if someone tried to treat a woman as if they're less equal than them. But saying that, that does not mean we're all exactly the same, you know. So it's in recognizing that, and that we begin to be able to approach our relationships in a hopefully rounded way. So in other words, here we are in this beautiful place here, and then, you know, I pick up the hoover and do a bit of hoovering. You know, men, we're probably very silly creatures. It would make a man feel very good if you said, oh, thank you, darling, you know, you've hoovered. You know? But possibly you do that all the time, and you never get a thank you, you see. But I don't know. Maybe men just need affirmation. Maybe we're those kind of creatures of affirmation. We need to some sort of affirmation.
Oh, that's such an interesting thing. Yeah. Because I think, you spot on. Well, I can't say I'm a woman, but you said men need affirmation.
Yeah.
And women, just to tell you a little secret.
Yeah, please, thank you.
They need reassurance.
Reassurance. Yeah? There you go.
So if you remember that we women, we need to give you lots of affirmation, yeah, and you're going to give us reassurance.
Reassurance.
I think we might be happy.
Everyone is happy.
And also, you said a beautiful thing. You said we are together, a woman and a man. We are in a relationship, and it's about sharing and about knowing that it's never going to be perfect. So that's the journey. Because when we expect the perfection, we can't ever get there because we are already building the thick wall between each other.
Exactly.
Dumi, thank you so much for coming. Tell me the closest event you've got, and because we've got listeners from all over the world, so tell me, London or where are you going to be?
London, you can catch us at the Zim Achievers Awards. I'll be one of the performers there.
It's going to be
actually the date has escaped me, but you can look up, we've got a website, Zim Achievers Awards.
Check out the website.
Yeah. If you're in Africa, I'm coming to Africa in July, and we may be going together. And we may be meeting in Africa. So, I'm looking to perform in Malawi, South Africa, and maybe work my way up. So, you know, we will meet in Africa as well.
So, if I know any news, I will keep you posted about Dumi's journeys. Okay.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. It's been a real pleasure.
Thank you very much.
I wish you all the best, and please keep spreading the beautiful peace.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you for your support. Thank you for having me. Cheers.
As Dumi said in his beautiful poem, love dearly, not nearly, merely. So let's be courageous. Let's live the identity of our heart, as that will create the culture based on love. And where there is love, there's no fear. So here's a question for you. What culture do you want for yourself? If you feel you've got something you want to share and help the world love in a better way, email me to ceo@cityofheart.org.uk and be my future guest. Right now, you were listening to the radio show with Miss B. This is it for today, and I'm looking forward to being with you next week. So until then, stay blessed.